Hi, in this video, we're going to talk about the 6 clinical trajectories of concussion. And a lot of this information comes from this book, Concussion, A Clinical Profile Approach to Assessment and Treatment by Anthony Kontos and Mickey Collins. And it is a great book, lots of great information. We're also going to talk from some of that supporting literature. This is really exciting for me, this area, because typically concussion had been thought of as kind of a singular thing, and it's not. And the research is showing that it is really can be broken down into 6 clinical trajectories. And first I'm going to go through those and then tell you a little bit more about them. And I just want to show you the bottom of this one. This information is coming from UPMC, University of Pittsburgh Medical Center, and their Rethink Concussion. This is their infographic, and it shows the 6 different types. And so one is cognitive fatigue, and that is characterized by both of those things. And sometimes you'll see the fatigue increase as the day progresses. Vestibular is the next one, and this is any impairment of the vestibular or the balance part of the brain, and it can affect your ability to interpret motion, coordinate head and eye movements, or stabilize vision upon head movements. And it's okay if you can't read these, because this is right in the reference section of both of the toolkits, and so you can pull it up, you can read it, take a look at it. It's really great. We wanted it there as a reference for you. Ocular is the next one, and this is when the movements of the eyes, in either in tandem or one by itself, is not right. It's affected, and it might be difficult to bring the eyes together or to move them to track motion. Post-traumatic migraine is the next, and this is what it sounds like. It is migraines, headaches, nausea, sensitivity to light or noise afterwards. Cervical is one that also is just particularly exciting to me, because we would often see, so I've been working in the field for many years and in the downstream world of rehab, where we would finally find these folks floundering after many, many years, or a year, 6 months, 9 months, but a while. Sometimes years. And cervical is one that if you saw that the mechanism of injury was substantial, like a fall down the stairs or a car accident, where it's likely that the neck would have gone out of alignment or the back, then it's appropriate at some point to have a referral to someone who specializes in that, because a cervical misalignment alone can mimic concussion symptoms. Now, it could be that you've got both. You've got a cervical misalignment and you've got concussion. But we want to take that out of the equation by assessing it and treating it. Anxiety and mood was another one that was very exciting to me, because we would see these folks who were presenting with anxiety, with mood disturbance, depression, and we would find that, and it, they kind of got, in a sense, blamed for it, that it's kind of this sense of, well, if only you were stronger, well, if only you would buck up and get through it. But this is a known outcome to concussion at this point. And we want to get those people some very specific help and respect that this is brain-based. And now I want to show you the accompanying, this is on the back side of the document. We created this from the UPMC information and Kontos and Collins and all of that research. And it goes through the 6 types there, and that's color coordinated to match the other side that you just saw. And with these symptoms, they're going to be broad and generalized during that first week following concussion. So you're not going to see them at that first visit to the doctor's office. Generally, they're going to present with things like headache and fatigue. And then after that first week, if symptoms persist, they may not. But if they do, then they're going to start to tend to fall into one or more of these six clinical trajectories. So it's not always going to be so neat and tidy that you're going to have one. And then the trajectory that you see in someone depends on several factors. It's the direction of force. Is it linear or is it rotational? The location of the impact. Where did you hit the head? Or remember that concussion, you don't have to hit the head. It can be a whiplash injury. The amount of force that were involved. And then pre-injury risk factors. And again, I'm sorry if I get real excited about this, but this next part of active treatment is also a new concept. Not to folks who dealt with this. They would definitely go treat symptom specific, but for the rest of the world, this is brand new information, and research is showing that active specialized treatment, if we focus on the specific symptoms, this helps the brain to recover from injury. So who are some of those specialized places that we can send them to? A neuropsychologist would be appropriate, a vestibular physical therapist, for exertional physical therapy, physical medicine and rehab, neuro-optometry, neuro-ophthalmology, an orthopedist, a neurosurgeon, neuroradiology, chiropractic, or cognitive therapy like speech-language therapy. You might find that in a brain injury unit or a specialized TBI unit. They would all be familiar with that. So we want to find the treatment that is tailored to their specific symptoms. And the research on this is so promising. There is a type of active research for each type of concussion or each trajectory. So we are no longer putting someone in a quiet, dark room that doesn't provoke their symptoms. In fact, the research shows that that will actually prolong their symptoms. And instead, we are providing them with active treatment. Our concussion protocol is saying do it by 4 weeks. Please have them come back by 4 weeks because most people will clear their symptoms. But if you have someone that you feel like needs treatment sooner, obviously refer them sooner. With some of the sports concussion clinics, with elite athletes, they will see them right away. So some risk factors are also on the back, which might delay recovery. So things like a history of prior concussions, motion sickness, visual problems, learning or attention issues, migraine history, the female gender, and then age. Children tend to take longer to recover. So great information really changes the way we think about concussion. And just one more time, I'd like to thank the folks at UPMC and Rethink Concussion for allowing us to use that infographic in our toolkits and our trainings.